And now you want to talk about Donald Trump, right?
Just before we go on to Q&A, I just have a single question to ask you. So you've publicly very, very kind of direct in saying that like army officials shouldn't be, or military officials shouldn't be involved in politics. I think you wrote a letter about the RNC, the Michael Flynn.
I did.
Why do you think that politicians shouldn't be involved in politics in that way?
Well, politicians shouldn't be involved in politics at all. That's for sure.
Military officials shouldn't
be involved. Well, we've seen how they've done with it, so you're right. They should be involved. First of all, let me put a little... Donald and I admitted earlier we're two men separated by a common language. He sent a... I have four people traveling with me, and he sent a note over to me and said, there'll be a taxi for one coming at to your hotel. And I thought, what the hell am I going to do with a taxi for one? And what does a taxi for one look like anyway? Like, is it a little tiny taxi with little seats and a little ashtray and a little steering wheel? And he, of course, he meant for 1 o'clock. And me being the American literalist, I was looking for a taxi at 1 o'clock. So we had to go through that. Donald said military officials. What I said specifically and really still believe is that when you're a general or an admiral, you're a general and an admiral for life. In our system, you know, you didn't introduce me tonight as, you know, Martin Dempsey, Knight of the British Empire, you know, a handsome, dashing cavalry officer with the voice of an angel, right?
I didn't get your speech in the end.
Yeah. You introduced me as General Dempsey, and I will always be general, even to some, you know, to relatives in some cases, I'm General Dempsey. So, and in our system, which I think is unique, by the way. When we take our oath, we take it to the Constitution. So we take an oath to a set of ideas. I mean, literally, a piece of paper with ideas on it. And you look at most other militaries in the world, they will generally take an oath to a sovereign or to the country. In some cases, in the worst of cases, to a political system. We don't do that. We take our oath to a set of ideas, and because of that, the American people expect and really demand of us to be nonpartisan, because our political system changes, and if there's reason for one party or the other to believe that the military is more or less favorable to them, it's gonna have an effect. And so that was the motivation. The other part of it was, when I left the job, I realized that if I wanted to, I could make my successor's life really hard. I mean, really, all I got to do is get on Fareed Zakaria or Fox and Friends or whatever it is, and say, you know, that I don't think we're headed in the right direction with our policy toward Afghanistan or Iraq or Syria or, you know, North Korea, Iran. You know, pick a nightmare. All I've got to do is say, I don't think we're on the right track. And you know, next thing you know, it runs two or three news cycles. And it also generates some suspicion inside the White House that generals are political, and we're not supposed to be. Now, I will talk about the issues all day long, but never vis-a-vis a particular party or a particular personality.
Okay. Very nice. Does anyone have questions from the floor? I think, yourself.
Yes, thank you. Sir, my name's actually Second Lieutenant. My name is Melty. I'm a 2016 grad.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, actually, I met you on a couple of occasions, and I was very excited to see that you're coming to UCD of all places. I was going to ask the same question, knowing how politically divisive our society, but also just the West, I mean, in the last few months and last few years. But being in the civilian academic environment this year compared to West Point, too, I was also curious, you know, your perspective on intellectualism in the military.
Yeah.
Not just the U.S. military, but you know, you've served with officers from around the world, and I think I will as well. And the dialogue that I'm having this year is very different than a lot of dialogues I had at West Point and in the Army. And so there seems to be a divide, and I sense a divide from a lot of my peers who are, you know, serving in Germany right now with their infantry joes. There's a huge strain of anti-intellectualism, and it scares me. And so I was just wondering, from your experience, you probably saw the whole trajectory of it since Vietnam, kind of what learning points we can take from that as civilian practitioners of security and military practitioners of security, and also sort of the warning signs that we should be looking out for.
Yeah, I will tell you, I've never... Let me extrapolate what you said for the audience. So because I got to be the senior military officer in the entire United States of America, I must have been really stupid. No, I'm kidding. You didn't say that. But here's what I really want to say. I never experienced an anti-intellectualism in the military. What I experienced sometimes was a rejection of intellectual arrogance. And here's what I mean by that. Military officers are expected to give advice to our civilian leaders. They own decisions. Sure. That our system is, you get elected and you take responsibility, and you're free to get advice from wherever you want to get it. The way a president gets advice, I'll tell you briefly, is some of you wear glasses. You go to the eye doctor and you got this thing on your face, you know, and they say, is that clear? Or is this clear? That filter or this filter? Yeah, right? Isn't that how you get glasses? And eventually you give up and say, just give me the goddamn glasses. I can't tell you what's clear, but I know those look okay. And I look cool in them, so I'm going to wear them. And off I go. But that's how our president makes decisions. He gets foreign policy advice, economic advice. He gets political advice. He gets military advice. And he doesn't have to take it, right? So where I have experienced something that you might be describing as anti-intellectualism is when there's a little bit of intellectual arrogance on the side of it. You know, I went to Harvard, so man, how come I can't be a general? I went to Harvard. What more do they want me to do? You know, and we've had a few people like that. Remember what I said about this building a genuine sense of belonging? If you do that, to do that, by the way, you have to be approachable and you have to be somewhat humble. That's the core of what it means to be a leader. You develop the expertise, which we're now talking about as kind of intellectualism. You develop moral courage, even more than physical courage, and you try to be humble about it. You do that, people will accept, embrace you, build trust in you, and have a relationship with you. If you're wearing your Harvard degree on your sleeve, and then you don't get picked to go to a particular job, you're going to blame it. Couldn't possibly be me. It must be that people don't like Harvard. And that's how that happens. So, by the way, I'm not anti-Harvard now that you mentioned it. Yeah.
People said, what was the utility of the League of Nations if the U.S. did not join? So what was the utility of international law and the Hague if the U.S. would be reluctant at times to subject itself to
it? Yeah, did you say the League of Nations?
Refresh,
just let me hear that one more time.
People said, what was the utility of the League of Nations as an analogy?
Yeah.
When the U.S. did not join it. So what's the utility of international law in The Hague if the U.S. would retreat?
And you mean the ICC specifically?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, first of all, you will find in my particular background that I always advocated for UN conventions, for alliances, and for partnerships. And so, but I did that because I have a sense of history that says that after World War II, the United States charted its path into the future through allies and partners. You know, whether it was we have 53 allies and partners, far, far more than anyone else in the world, probably by a magnitude of 52. So I believe that we should be actively involved in international, multinational organizations like the United Nations. I'm going to come back to that in a second. The ICC is a little different. And I say that because the International Criminal Court has had a history of, are you a student of it? Somewhat? It's had a history of politicization and corruption, actually. And there are people and by the way, I would venture to say, with no hubris intended, that the United States military holds itself to a higher standard of rules of engagement, law of armed conflict, rule of law, precision than anyone else who uses force in the entire world. There have been people in our Congress, and at some point these agreements have to pass through the Congress of the United States, who don't want to give up the sovereignty that comes with being subjected to have U.S. soldiers subjected to the International Criminal Court. In this case, I agree with them, mostly because of the way the ICC has behaved itself, frankly. But things like UN Convention on Law of the Sea, which we're not a party to, but I argued we should be, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which we didn't get off the ground, but I've argued that we should have, to use the economic weight of the United States more often than the military weight. So I guess I would suggest to you is, I believe firmly that the United States should be party to as many multinational organizations as we can. But those multinational organizations have to, you know, they can't be anti-American and hope to attract Americans, because we got the Congress sitting between us and them.
Any other questions?
Hi, sir. My question has to involve around the recent pull by the president and his budget to increase military spending.
Right.
First of all, there's a lot of debate on whether it's necessary or not. Do you think it's necessary or not? And if so, where do you think that increase in military spending should go towards? Because, for example, if we're continuing to pivot to Asia and investing more in PACOM, perhaps the Navy should get more resources in the Air Force, however focused on...
Where are you from, by the way?
I'm from Ashland, Massachusetts.
Okay. I didn't pick up an Irish accent, that's right. You'll get one before you leave, by the way.
But suppose we're saying in the Middle East, CENTCOM would probably require more Army forces and Marines. So in which direction do you see next military going forward?
Yeah, that's a great question. And first of all, no budget increase should be proposed absent a strategy to articulate it. Look, when I was in uniform and even now, I mean, yes, we do need more money, but we need it, it doesn't do any good in our system to have one administration say, you need more money, and then just give you the money. And the next administration says, you don't need more money, and take it away. And we're in a bit of a cycle now where we can't agree. And what we really ought to be agreeing on is, what the hell is our strategy? What exactly are we trying to accomplish as a nation? And what I mean by that is, we've got five real security issues that we're trying to deal with. Doesn't mean that we're going to have a confrontation with all five, but they're a factor. Russia and China, two heavyweights. Iran and North Korea, two middleweights. And then a movement that stretches from Afghanistan to Nigeria. It's not radical Islamic. It is radical Islamist. And, you know, I'm a real student of language. You know what Mark Twain said: the difference between the right word and the wrong word is like the difference between lightning and lightning bug. And so you better get the right word. And the right word is radical Islamist groups. Islamist means taking religion for political purposes to try to establish influence in geographies like caliphates and things. Islamic means of the religion, and it's not about the Islamic faith. I've spent more time in the Middle East than almost any of my peers, and have come to the firm belief that it's completely misguided to turn this into a conflict with the Muslim faith. But we do have to be careful of radical Islamist groups that stretch from Afghanistan to Nigeria. Okay, each of those requires a different toolkit. You know, the toolkit you're using against terrorism in Iraq and Afghanistan is not applicable to deterring Russia from expanding its influence in Eastern Europe, or it's not conducive to deterring China in the South China Sea, and it's not, doesn't do a damn bit of good for trying to convince Kim Jong-un not to fire nuclear-capable ballistic missiles, or Iran from conducting cyber attacks and sponsoring state-sponsored terrorism through Lebanese Hezbollah. So what we need is a military that's capable of doing more than one thing. It does need to be refreshed a bit. Our equipment has gotten quite beaten up over the last 10 years. And we're a little smaller than we need to be, but not dramatically smaller than we need to be. And I just hope we don't take the money away from places like diplomacy or from the Coast Guard. You know, the Coast Guard is not a military arm. It's a law enforcement arm. So we'll see. I mean, I count on those I left behind, who I hope are protégés and like-minded with me, who will, as they look at this budget increase, will understand that, you know, some of it should be invested in human capital, some of it in modernization. But the other thing we got is we've got too much infrastructure. We've got about 20% of our bases. We just don't need them anymore, but we can't close them. Some of our weapon systems have aged out, but we can't retire them. Because in our system, if there's a base in Massachusetts, you can't close it, because the congressman whose constituents live there don't want the base to close. So we got some We'll figure it out. By the way, I promise you, you know what they say about America? We'll always do the right thing after it's tried. Everything else, we'll do the right thing. So.
Great quote. Is there any questions from the side of the audience? Yeah, yourself.
Yeah.
Upon reading an article, I found out that Lockheed Martin, I think, with the F-35 program, have received over $1.5 trillion from U.S. Congress over the past 20 years. So that's made me question, does the military-industrial complex, at least in your opinion anyway, perhaps have a potential stranglehold on America even?
No, it's a great question. In fact, it was Eisenhower back in 1952 or 3. That's when I was born, by the way, who said, beware the military-industrial complex. And what he was talking about, one of the marks of an educated man or woman is to be able to hold two completely opposed ideas in your head simultaneously. I'm about to demonstrate that. So I always found myself concerned about the defense industry and its influence in Congress, you know, because they pay enormous amounts of money to help congressmen get elected, which in turn, I mean, it's all regulated, it's all transparent, but it's, you know, they cast a long shadow, these multi-billion dollar corporations in defense. Now, they also do some pretty good work for us. The gear that we get from them, it probably is, you know, it probably does run into production longer than it needs to, and it probably ends up costing more than it should, but it works. I mean, we have an incredible track record of success with the equipment. And by the way, we want to be the best armed in the world. I mean, you know, that wouldn't surprise you. If you're gonna get asked to go fight someplace, you don't want to say, and you know what, I'll take like the third most expensive piece of gear there and just, I can make it work. No, you're not going to do that. You're going to say, give me the thing that is far better than anybody else can possibly develop, and it's going to be expensive. I actually like that part of Mr. Trump's presidency where he's challenging and maybe even taunting the defense establishment to run their costs down. I don't know that we've ever had a president do that. I'm not sure it's appropriate even, to tell you the truth. But it's entertaining and it might work. And so, you know, let's see what happens. I mean, if he can get them in a room and say, look, you know, we can't pay $1.36 trillion for the F-35. Some of that money's already sunk cost, by the way. But, you know, so there are some limitations on what he can do. So I don't mind the pressure, but I also don't want you to think I'm anti-defense establishment because, you know, they believe in their hearts, they're both making a living, but also producing products that keep men and women alive, our men and women alive on the battlefield and give us an advantage. So, yeah, I do worry about it. It's probably under far more scrutiny than you think. You know, the idea that we've been, pardon my language, effing it up for the last 10 years is just not right. The system itself has a series of checks and balances in it, safety checks, congressional oversight. So I don't think we're going to be able to drive the cost of Air Force One down dramatically. I mean, I don't think we're going to get it for like, you know, $150,000. It's probably still going to be north of $3 billion, but maybe he can knock it down a little bit. And, you know, look, I mean, any president at some point, look, he's in his, what, 47th day or something? I don't know. I don't think, I'm not ready to, you know, jump overboard yet because every president eventually feels the pressure of a re-election. If it's not his, it's those that are holding on to his coattails. And that pressure begins to manifest itself in, okay, we got it, you're doing a lot for defense, but what are you doing for, where's your infrastructure idea? Where'd that go? You know, the Obamacare replacement is gonna be hotly debated. And all those debates are debates until you put money on them. That, you know, look, what they say in America, and I'm sure it's here too, if the Taoiseach were sitting there, he'd agree with me. Everything is rhetoric, the budget is real. That's when you know where your government's going, where it puts the money. And it's a little too soon to tell.
Yeah. Any more questions? Yeah, yourself.
Yeah.
Hi, General, thanks for being here.
My pleasure.
I'm from not too far from you, I'm
Staten Island. Oh yeah? Real? What the hell? How did you all get out? My water.
Your water's behind you there.
I read beforehand that four of your troops went to Iraq and had to go
Sure.
I want to ask about how effective you thought that was, and maybe just a little bit on kind of what the perception on the ground from average citizens in Iraq was on Americans being there.
Yeah, let me start at the end. You know, the average citizen in Iraq is about as hard to identify as the average citizen in Dublin or the average citizen in, you know, in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Maybe even a little harder. And I say that because, look, what happened in Iraq was there were decades, and I might even be able to argue centuries of animosity that had been. So look, here's what happened in the Middle East in general. We went from a period of imperialism. I mean, you go back and look at history. There was a period of imperialism where the great European powers generally, you know, sponsored or took surrogates or, you know, find your word, you know, noblesse oblige, whatever word they chose, they came into the Middle East and Africa for two reasons, let's face it. Three, influence, resources, but also I think out of a genuine sense of being able to try to help the people in there. But when they got there, they realized they knew very little about it. That's what happened to us in Iraq too, but I'll come back to that. They knew very little about it. So generally speaking, imperialism began to get a bad name. Nobody wanted to be called an imperialist. So what happened? They picked a tribe, or they picked a group, or they picked an individual, and they prepared them to take, because they wanted to give it back. So if you're in Rwanda, I want to give it back. I don't want it anymore. We tried that in Iraq too. I'll come back to that. And they didn't want it. No, thank you. But they had to get, if they wanted to get out of there, they had to give it to somebody. They gave it to somebody, but that somebody eventually became a strong man. And we went through an entire cycle of history in strong men, political dominant. Generally, it was good for stability. If you talk to Iraqis today, some of them will wish that Saddam was back. And you say, you cannot be true. Yeah, can't be right, but it is. It's stable, but it's not equitable. The resources, it's corrupt, it's inequitable. It's all the things that come with a name like Muammar Gaddafi, okay? So anyway, and then all of a sudden, the strong men got to be affected by digital echoes, you know? Along came the information age, people said, holy crap, we got it that bad? I didn't know. You mean people out there have iPhones and stuff, and I'm sucking along here with a flip phone? And so, all of a sudden, Arab Spring, you know, fruit vendor in Tunisia, and by the way, the Western world says, yeah, this is what we've been waiting for, until they saw what happened, which is nobody's in charge, and these decades and centuries of animosity. And what happens is everybody rushes for the trough and says, it's my turn. Anybody Iraqi here? I mean, because I don't want to talk to your history. I never saw anything like, Iraq, by the way, had every reason to succeed. Education, agriculture, water. Nobody in the Middle East has water. Iraqi has water. A moderate education system, moderate religion. It's hard to even think about that now. But when the lid blew off and there was the trough, they rushed it. And they were elbowing, it's my turn. And they set themselves back a decade. Now, you might say, well, you should have saw that coming. Yeah, maybe, but we didn't see it coming. So when you say, what did the average person on the street think about American soldiers? First thing is, we were treated extraordinarily well early on. But then our political leaders took the top four layers out of all of the ministries. Ministry of Oil, Ministry of Electricity, Ministry of Public Works. Nobody's collecting trash. The sewer system collapsed because we took anybody that could possibly run it, we took them out. That's a bad way to put it. We fired them, sent them home, and it collapsed. It was a failed state. Then they got mad at us. They said, well, wait a minute. You know, and you know, frankly, it was probably predictable. And then they said, come on, I used to get this myself. They'd say, come on, General, I was there for 14 months and then 22 months with a year in between. So I came back, they were saying, hey, good to see you again. General, by the way, how come you can't get this fixed? You know, you guys put a man on the moon in 1960. I can't tell you how many times I heard this. You put a man on the moon in 1969 and you can't fix my goddamn electricity? It was in Arabic too, so I was really insulted. But in any case, that's the way they felt about it. So the kid on the street, who by the way, look, if we had at the high water mark 175,000 soldiers there, I'm going to concede to you right now that 2% of them were angry about being there, didn't like Iraqis, didn't like Muslims, didn't like themselves maybe. You know, I mean, at the end of the day, we're all human beings. So 2% of 175,000 is a big number, and you had to watch that. The other 98%, unbelievable, really. I mean, putting up with all kinds of stuff and trying to do their best every day to go out there and put this thing back on its feet. I think we're on the right track now. So what did we do the first three times? 91, 2003, 2007. We rushed in, we took control, we polished it up. You know, we made the electricity work, we built new buildings, we got the sewage system working. Not much effort on Iraqi's part, frankly. And then we tried to give it back. And they said, okay, thanks. And they went to the trough again. So what are we doing this time? We're not rushing in. We're not doing it for them. We're providing enormous amounts of support. This time, instead of owning the house, we built a scaffolding around it. And we're fixing the shutters here and there. And they got the plumbing. They got the electricity. If they want windows, they put the windows in. We might be there to explain to them that the windows should be put in, you know, kind of vertical, not horizontal. But whatever it takes, we're going to be there. And they're doing the fighting, and we're doing the support. And it's their country, and by the way, it's working. And as a result, they actually think more of us now than they did before. So that's a long-winded answer to say, we worked our bottoms off to try to get soldiers ready to understand the culture, the religion, the tribal relationships. You know, if you were in the north with the Kurds, you needed one set of skills. If you were in the south with the Shia, you needed another set of skills. In fact, you could really insult someone if you weren't careful, applying, you know, the skills in the wrong place. So it was a lot of work. It remains a lot of work. But I think we got the right answer now. Thank you. What else? Yeah, you pick them.
Oh,
yeah. I don't want to make anybody mad. I like the people who like me.
Yeah. I've actually got a question from my dad. He's a retired lieutenant colonel in the U.S. Army.
Really?
Yeah, he was actually stationed in Wiesbaden from 2001 onward.
We might have served together then.
Yes, he was actually the chief operational officer of the first AV.
Really?
Under Sanchez, I think.
Yeah.
And Casey, really? Which was right before
you. Yeah, right before me. Yeah.
Anyways, his question is energy related.
Yeah.
Actually, energy security related. So he says that there is an inherent risk in using finite energy resources that can be extended through sustainability and energy efficiency measures, but at some point they will be exhausted. But then there's also the option of laying out enormous capital sums to research into renewable energy resources. But that's not necessarily those that already exist. It can be something new. He says every 50 years there's essentially a new development
sure.
of energy.
Yeah.
And such as the Manhattan Project was the precursor to using nuclear energy. So he says, how do you balance and weigh the risks of both of these options to become more energy secure nation and also to become more sustainable eventually?
Wow, didn't see that coming.
Sorry.
No, I can actually answer it though. First of all, let me say that food security and energy security will be the security issues of your time, much more so than it was during my time. I mean, you know, back to the Middle East, things like the the Israeli-Palestinian conflict will never be solved until they figure out water. Forget the politics. They got to figure out water. I mean, you know, the settlements generally go where the water is, and therefore, if they ever can get to something that sounds like a two-state solution, they got to figure out water. So, and that's just not in Israel and Palestine. I mean, that's around the world. So, water and food and security, and now let me jump into energy security. I actually think the energy sector in the United States is on the leading edge of what will be. Sort of a glimpse of the future that your dad is alluding to. Here's what I mean. If I had a conversation with somebody in the energy industry probably 10 years ago, and by the way, Bill Higgs was in the oil sector as in an engineering capacity. So maybe I'll just volleyball the question over there. But what 10 years ago, if you talk to there's 900 gas and electricity companies in the United States, roughly. But there's nine of them that are dominant. And those nine, for 10 years ago, were trying to stiff arm renewables. And I used to say to people on occasion, to prove that I'm right about people are alert to fossil fuels but not alert to other things, I'd say, how much do you pay for a gallon of gas when you're in America? Yeah, just give me a number. You're going to be right, whatever you say. $2.30
now.
Yeah, okay, that's a good guess, $2.30. How much do you pay for a kilowatt hour of electricity? You have no idea. We don't. You know, gas company sends you a bill, you pay it, you're happy about it. That's not going to stay that way forever. So here's what's going to happen. The major industries are, they're not stiff-arming renewables anymore. Because here's the interesting way to think about this. The big industries are willing to give up some control in order to preserve power. That's a big intellectual, that sounds counterintuitive. But they've decided they're going to give up some control to things like renewables, but also to their customers in order to preserve their power. I think that, and here's what I mean by that. So what they'll say is they'll embrace renewables. They'll try to incorporate them into the grid that's still mostly dominated by gas and electricity. They'll go to customers and say, look, if you are willing to be part of the grid, if you can produce energy back into the grid, and we can distribute it for you. So now they've still got the power because they're the distributors. But they're harvesting knowledge at the edge here. They're harvesting power at the edge, or not power, but energy. I think that's the way the world's going to go. That's why ideas about, you know, that big corporations can stay kind of isolated, that countries can stay isolated. I don't think it's possible. I think, and in fact, one of the things I used to counsel as the chief military leader of our country was that the wave of the future is we're going to have to give up some control if we want to preserve our power. Remember what I said, Russia, China, Iran, Korea, and from Afghanistan to Nigeria. We can't do that ourselves. So what do? I don't know, maybe you find a way to build coalitions that really matter, that really contribute, that, you know, that can share values over time. But in the process, you might actually have to give up a little control. And the energy sector is on the leading edge of it. So tell your father, this is going to take care of itself. Because doing it yourself is too expensive. And therefore, it'll take care of itself.
So earlier you mentioned two heavyweights, China and Russia. I know it's kind of a broad question, but what kinds of policies or what kind of stance do you think the U.S. should take towards those countries, given that, say, Russia has been acting recently much more militarily, much more aggressively than it has in decades, and China's building a
partnership? So I might not be right about this, but I believe it, and I'll use it to answer your question. You all will have to probably figure this out as you go forward. Here's what I think. Remember I said that the U.S.'s path to security, both from 1950 till now, but also in the future, is through allies and partners, and that we have a very exquisitely developed and carefully managed system of allies and partners. That's clearly the path for America. If you're the status quo power, we're the status quo power, right? What does a status quo power want to preserve at all costs? The status quo, because we own the advantages. And so, but remember what I said, we're going to probably have to see places where we can relinquish some control in order to preserve power. And I think the way we'll do that is through allies and partners. Okay. Let me go to Russia real quickly. Russia, if you look beyond 2020, every one of Russia's indicators, whether it's demographics, economics, the 11 time zones they're trying to manage, the ethnic composition of the country, are in decline. The Russian population itself is creeping along just under one live birth per family. And to preserve a society takes 2.1. By the way, how does the United States stay above 2.1? Immigration. That's why this conversation about immigration is so important. And that's missing in the conversation, but that is a fact. So back to the point. We preserve our society through immigration. Russia is in decline and doesn't preserve its society through that. And economically, they're in recession, and one might argue, actually, in depression. So if you're Putin, you say, okay, after 2020, I got nothing. I got nothing in the tank. Nobody wants my gas. Nobody wants my oil. You know, my vodka's being, you know, pirated in, you know, Massachusetts. They're making vodka, for God's sakes. So what am I going to do? Well, old school. I mean, it's old school diplomacy and coercion. I mean, they're going to reestablish a sphere of influence that's going to bump right up into the NATO countries. They're leaning heavily into the gray states that sit between. You know, in 1991 to 2008, NATO pushed its eastern border 1,000 miles to the east. Now, if you're Russia, that's you know, it's a provocative act. If you're NATO, it's you're just trying to make sure that like-minded countries can develop in an economic sphere of freedom, you know, with all the freedoms that come with democracy. So we got this kind of disconnect between NATO, the United States, and Russia that really is based on they are on a much different path. They feel they have to reestablish a sphere of influence. They're doing it rather ham-handedly and, like I said, old-school coercion. And so what do? We just rely on our relationship with NATO. We strengthen NATO. We encourage NATO. And because the way we keep things stable in Europe is by ensuring that it doesn't become a bilateral conflict between Russia and the United States, but rather has the force of the NATO alliance. Okay. China. How many allies and partners does China have? Roughly. Roughly zero. They have some market partners. In China, it's all about supply chains. By the way, none of this is pejorative. I'm not saying Russia's stupid and China's, you know, dumb and we're smart. I'm just telling you the world as I see it. China's all about supply chains. They run a supply chain down the East China Sea, South China Sea. Why is that important now and it wasn't 10 years ago? Deep water drilling, thanks to Bill Hicks. Now they can get after the oil, and now they're really interested in it. And so they're running a supply chain that way. They're running one to Africa. They're running a supply chain to South America. Okay, so their policies are all about feeding their economic engine. Where does it get tricky? When our system of allies and partners rubs into Russia's sphere of influence, and where China's supply chains run into our system of allies and partners in the Pacific. Once you understand that, in other words, once you start with an understanding of the underlying reasons that we could find ourselves in confrontation, I think you can work through it. As opposed to just saying, oh my God, China's so wrong to be trying to take over, you know, the fiery cross reef in the South China Sea because, you know, they want oil. They're just so wrong to do that. I think there's ways that the United States and its allies and partners can, you know, can find a way to recognize China's instincts and its interest and find them to be, look, we, you know, frankly, what we care about in the South China Sea is freedom of navigation. So what we're, because that 80% of the commerce that goes to the western coast of the United States goes through the South China Sea. So yes, we're worried about these land reclamation things because they get cross-threaded with Japan and Philippines, our two allies, but we also don't want, you know, the economic exclusion. We don't want China saying, okay, now this is not a pile of rocks. Now it's an island. Now it's inhabited. Now, according to the UN Convention on Law of the Sea, we're going to establish a 200-kilometer economic exclusion zone, which means you don't have free right of passage. You've got to ask permission to move through our territorial waters. Because if you do that, then we got problems with freedom of navigation. So I think it's really all about understanding what motivates them and what motivates us, and I think on that basis we can probably deal with it.
Some questions from the back there. Hear yourself.
Hi. So there's a clear separation in the mandate from law enforcement and armed forces or the military, but there's during the U.S. Engagement in Iraq and Afghanistan, there seems to have been a large increase in the use of private contractors like Blackwater, later XE. What do you think about the use of private contractors, both from a strategic point of view, ethical point of view,
whether
the money should be spent?
That was a mistake. It was a mistake.
We have seen an increased military or kind of militarization of American police forces with the sheriff departments using armored vehicles and tactical assault rifles.
Yeah.
Any thoughts?
No, that has, so to the first about private security, that was a mistake, you know, in retrospect. because we started the conflict with an army that was too small. You know, back to your point, we had gone down to about. These numbers are gonna. You're gonna say, wait a minute. You know, the Irish Defense Force is like 4,000, and you're gonna be complaining because we were down to 475,000. But with global responsibilities, and when you really, you know, did the math, we were in a position where if we had to guard all the convoys and guard all the VIPs and diplomats, and we wouldn't have had people on the street doing the kind of things you were talking about with the Iraqis and against the insurgency. So, but it was a mistake. We started the conflict, and our army was too small. That's what happened. I don't know anybody that thinks we should aspire to use private security contractors in the future. And if we do, that we should certainly have a different standard of their performance and a different way to measure their performance and oversight. Oversight not just on their behavior, but on the money that they were making on the whole thing. And there are ethical implications. So I've said from the start that was a mistake. I think we've overcome it for the most part, not yet entirely, because they're still out there in some cases guarding diplomats in places of the world where we can't be. But I think the oversight, we started with no oversight, and we put a lot more oversight into it. The militarization or potential militarization of our law enforcement is a concern. Now, by the way, let me tell you how that happened, not by way of making excuses. So we were in Afghanistan, and we assessed that the Afghan army could absorb, as we were withdrawing, the Afghan army could absorb roughly 1,500 MRAPs. Those are mine-resistant, armored, what's the P? MRAP. Platform, maybe. Anyway, you know what an MRAP is. It's an armored car. We had about 5,000 in theater. They could absorb 1,500. So then we said to the services, do you want some? Meaning Army, mostly Army and Marine Corps. And then we retrograded some to them. That still left us with about 1,500. And so we started cutting them up, which, by the way, as it turns out, is expensive to cut up, you know, these armored vehicles. And so we started spending money. Once you start spending money, the Congress sees it. I mean, that's how our system works. The Congress watches the money. The executive branch watches the policy. Congress saw this money being expended to cut up the MRAPs, and they said, well, wait a minute. We're paying for these damn things twice. You know, we paid for them to give them to you. Now we're paying to cut them up. This doesn't make any sense. So they said, now that there's a legitimate or threat of domestic terrorism in the United States, maybe we ought to offer some of these things to law enforcement so they're not outgunned at times. You know, it's a good idea, you know, but good ideas can go bad. And the good idea went badly almost immediately when they used them in Ferguson. And Ferguson, if you recall, was a racial issue, and the local law enforcement used the MRAPs. And as soon as they did, I forget where I was, but I turned to my deputy and I said, that's the end of that program, because, you know, now you got MRAPs being used against U.S. citizens. We are done. I said, stop the presses. Don't ship anymore until we get advice. And, of course, the advice was stop shipping any more stuff to law enforcement. What's the answer? The answer is probably, and I'm not sure what they're going to do now. This is still a work in progress. What they probably ought to do is mothball some of this stuff at the state level with the National Guard, because the National Guard is a military organization used only in extremis. And you could make the case that they should have them. They know how to use them. They, you know, they're dressed as you know, it's just a better idea. But it doesn't stop, by the way, local law enforcement from spending money on high-end equipment off the market, you know. So it doesn't end the problem, but it gets us out of the media spotlight. But we have to be careful. I take your point.
We have time for a couple more questions.
Yeah, this is Lang Long Lady right here.
Hi. So going back to the South China Seas, you mentioned that, and you've been supporting the policy this entire time, that we should look at their interests and their needs.
Yeah.
But when they're not willing to see any other point but theirs, how can you start a diplomatic dialogue with them?
I have never found the Chinese to be that intransient, really. I mean, you know, I probably spent more time with my Chinese counterpart, who's like, and you know, in their system, it's just hard to figure out who the hell they are, really. As far as I can tell, my guy was like four guys down on the depth chart. and so pretty influential, both in the party as well as in the military. And so when I had conversations with him, they always started with the usual talking points. You know, he would sit there and dutifully say, you know, you guys are giving too much to Taiwan, you're invading our airspace, doing reconnaissance, you know, your stance in the South China Sea is unacceptable to our national interest. Haven't you forgotten about, or have you forgotten about the nine dash line and our assertions? And you know, you claim that you're preserving international order, but that international order was established when we weren't around. Now we're back. You know, it was, I mean, I could go on. I mean, and we do that for 30 minutes, and then I would do my particular talking points that the State Department gave me for 30 minutes. And then generally at the end, I'd close the book and I'd say, his name was Fong. I'd say, okay, Fong, we really need to talk about this, because I said, every time we get together, we say the same damn thing to each other. And he'd laugh, you know, and he'd kind of look around nervously, because he had people, political people, you couldn't tell who they were, but they were in the room, you know. But eventually, with a little perseverance, we got some work done. For example, there was no mechanism for me to contact him on an extremist business. We had to go before I solved it. But initially, I had to go through my embassy to their embassy, so U.S. Embassy Washington D.C. or State Department to U.S. Embassy Beijing, to State Department or Ministry of Foreign Affairs to, you know, the Politburo to check and see if the conversation could occur, and then over to Fong. And if I wanted to talk to him, it could take like 2 weeks, really, you know, to talk to the guy. So I said, look, we really got to, you know, we might have like a midair, you know, an unsafe intercept, or we might have an unsafe approach at sea. And I said, we really got to be able to talk about these things. And so we put a hotline in. And then like a year later, I said, okay, let's do that. But I said, this is the 21st century. What about a VTC, you know, or can I FaceTime you? I didn't say that. And so we put in a VTC. But it took us a year to get the approval on their side, because they were convinced if we're in there with a VTC, God knows where we're going, you know, in cyber. And so there's not a whole lot of trust there. Just there's not. So we got that done. We put rules of engagement in the air. You know, thou shalt not approach any closer than. And by the way, since we put the rules in, they haven't violated them. So, have you ever heard of the phrase Thucydides' trap? Thucydides wrote in the Peloponnesian War, and he wrote that it was the fear of rising Spartan military power that caused Athens to militarize, which was the start, and inevitably led to the Peloponnesian War, which lasted decades and took, you know, thousands, hundreds of thousands of lives. We have to be careful of a Thucydides trap with China. And what I mean by that is we're the status quo power. And generally speaking, status quo powers don't like rising powers. And generally, they will misinterpret the activities of rising powers, as the rising power will misinterpret the activities of the status quo power. It's just human nature. What's the answer? We got to be in their pocket, and they got to be in ours. And we got to be, you know, I mean, look, we can't be. I asked my Chinese counterpart, tell me what's most important. He said, okay. He said, I don't like to do this, but I'll tell you what I think is him. One China policy, number one. He said, non-negotiable. You know, anything that seems to threaten the one China policy, you can expect us to be really uncooperative about it. Second thing, of course, for them, is the nine dash line in the East China Sea, South China Sea. But he said, look, but, you know, he goes, it's a dash line. It's not a solid line. And what he was saying to me was, we know we're going to have to figure this out. But it's not me and you that have to figure it out. It's our political leaders. The third thing on the list, I think, was reconnaissance. We do reconnaissance just outside of the 12-mile limit. And they know it, and they don't like it. They don't like us collecting intelligence. And so we've actually kind of negotiated that. I told him, I said, look, if you were a little more transparent, you know, about some of your programs, like, you know, building submarines and building aircraft carriers, we might not be all that interested in watching you do it. And it's legal. We're in international airspace. And the last one was cyber. You know, we're always banging up into each other on cyber. But think about what I just said. He said, number one, one China policy. What's the first thing that happened in our new administration? We called into question the one China policy. I can't tell you how bad that was. Now, I think we've recovered. I hope. But that's why you've got to know, this isn't about, when you get into these positions of leadership, any of you, you just start to learn at that point. That's not when you finish learning. If you're not a lifelong learner, you're going to be a bad leader. And so you get in those positions, you try to understand before you act, and you can avoid things like a Thucydides trap. If you don't, you'll blunder into them. How many more?
I think we've got time for like two more.
Okay.
Yeah,
you pick. I don't want to make anybody mad. There's like five of them.
I know, it's like, I've noticed this guy's hand up for a while, so I come like to give him.
So, between General Mattis's Senate hearings, Lindsey Graham asked him a question about Israel and should the, I guess the consul be moved to Jerusalem.
That's right. The embassy.
Yeah, the embassy. My question is, how does he learn to negotiate this Christian Weltanschauung with regards to the Middle East and this perhaps notion that Israel's part of this Christian drama or that, I mean, Islam is this sort of, evil power within this sort of regional context?
Yeah. I just told you that what I thought when I became the chairman was the most complex problem I would face, China, that I thought that would be the one that would just torture me the whole time I was the chairman, and didn't. We actually made progress, and I began to understand and sort of conceive of a way forward, militarily anyway. I got nothing for you on the on the Middle East. I mean, So the Arab-Israeli conflict has, are you Israeli?
No.
I didn't pick up your accent. Where are you from?
Guatemala.
Boy, I swung and missed it, that one. the Arab-Israeli issue is really three issues. One is Israel itself. Israel, and what I say about Israel itself, Israel's going through a period where they're becoming more conservative. Their demographics are changing, and that portion of their demography that tended to be more moderate is beginning to become a little conservative, and conservative in the sense of political conservatism. But that political conservatism also manifests itself in less open-mindedness about a two-state solution. So that's, I'm going to get to the two-state solution in a second, but the Israeli population itself is changing. And by the way, the anti-Semitism that kind of comes and goes, actually, around the world, to include right now a bit of it coming back in the United States, completely unsettles Israel. I mean, the psychological impact of a bunch of teenage boys or whoever it is knocking over a Jewish headstone in a cemetery in Philadelphia reverberates in the state of Israel in an uncanny way. And so their population is a little less, they feel less safe than they've ever felt. And yet, by the way, they used to have states around them that could threaten them. I mean, Egypt attacked them, Jordan attacked them, Syria attacked them. Now there is no more Syria. Jordan is just holding on by a thread. Egypt is trying to figure out itself in the post-Morsi, you know, el-Sisi thing. So really, there's no state threat. Well, I mean, they would say Iran and with, you know, intercontinental ballistic missiles. But the point is, nobody's going to invade Israel today. And yet, the people themselves are as unsettled as I've ever seen them. Okay, that's one act. That's one factor. The second one you've alluded to, which is, you know, Jerusalem is the holiest place in Christianity. It's the holiest place in Judaism, and it's the third holiest place in the Muslim world after Mecca and Medina. You know, so they all want it. I mean, you know, everybody's got a fist into the middle of it. And even when we were looking at a post-67 UN Security Council resolution, two-state solution, Jerusalem was going to be a shared, kind of an open city. It was going to have shared responsibility. That's why announcing, we passed a law in the 90s that we'd move our embassy to Jerusalem, but no president has chosen to do it because they didn't want to unhinge whatever negotiations were taking place. And it would unhinge it, by the way. I don't know. I don't think we're going to move it, by the way. I think maybe this is a way to jumpstart the negotiations, I hope. But we shouldn't move it, in my personal judgment. The third thing, and the hardest one of all, this is why this issue is so difficult, is water. Remember I said earlier, water? The problem with a two-state solution is that in order for a state to exist, it's got to have the ability to feed itself, so it's got to have arable land and it's got to have water. And the way that things have occurred over time with settlements and you know, redistricting and things, there would be no possibility of that if they froze everything today and said to the Palestinians, okay, look, we've got some settlements out here. We're gonna give you back the West Bank, but we got these settlements out here. We're gonna keep those. We'll wall them off, and we'll add up the acreage, and we'll give you the land someplace else. So it won't be on the West Bank, but maybe it'll be down in the, you know, in the desert. Well, you know, Palestinians aren't gonna take that because there's nothing down there. I mean, it's literally desert, and unless we discover a way to make water, you know, without water. I mean, there are ways to do it. It takes, you know, salt water, you can desalinate it. But the problem is, you know, there's just, I don't see any way to do it. So I don't know how to answer your question, except to say we shouldn't move our embassy because it puts us right in the damn middle of it. And I think there's gonna be some tough times ahead before that happens, so.
Perfect. We have time for like maybe not just one last question, but maybe a couple more, maybe, okay. Hopefully. Sorry. Yeah, you're on the back. Yeah, you're on the red, sorry.
Almost all the experts agree that it's only a matter of time before North Korea develop ICBMs. And so I was just wondering what you think the U.S. response should be to that,
Yeah, my advice, I'll tell you what I used to advise. First of all, we shouldn't try to solve this without, you can't solve this without China, period. Until we gain Chinese cooperation, we're not going to accomplish anything. It's on China's border. Even, you know, putting defensive systems over there, we have a thing called THAAD, Theater High Altitude Air Defense, which picks up ballistic missiles in their final phase, which makes it really valuable, and it's really good. So we have 28,000 soldiers in South Korea. The population of Seoul is like 10 million, and it sits, you know, 70 kilometers from the demilitarized zone. So North Korea could really inflict an unbelievable carnage if they chose to, with nuclear weapons or with conventional artillery. And they threaten to do it. But they threaten to do it, by the way, back to what motivates countries. What North Korea is really interested in doing is preserving itself, the regime, period. I don't think they really want to be influential, but the problem is they are so oppressive and such a state sponsor of the proliferation of nuclear technology, cyber issues. And so, you know, the rest of the civilized world feels like it's a cancer sitting there, you know, waiting to spread. And so, and they know that. And so they believe the only way to protect themselves against that is through the acquisition of nuclear weapons. Because, for example, they'll say this, if Gaddafi hadn't given up his chemical weapons, nobody would have ever attacked them. So that's their motivation. It's all about regime preservation. But because of that, China's the answer. China and South Korea are the answer. But heretofore, we haven't really been able to get China's cooperation. I'm not sure exactly why. I mean, we've been working it, but I'll just simply leave that and then go to something else, which is, so China's number one. We gotta have China on board. Second, we do have to put a very effective defensive bubble around North Korea, and we've got it almost there. We've got very capable systems in South Korea. We have very capable systems afloat. We have some land-based in the United States. If we put this thing called THAAD in, it makes it even more effective. And we've got some sitting in that we sold to Japan, and so they've got them. So we've got a pretty effective bubble. The problem is, I think you probably know this, the Japanese and the South Koreans have historical animosities that won't allow them politically to work together. So the way you make a weapon system effective is you link it. You share information, you share intelligence real time, you know, so that something happens over here, all US, Japan, and Korea would know about it. And therefore, the system can orient itself to deal with it. We don't have that. We don't have that because we have it's called the JISOMIA, an information agreement with Korea, and we've got one with Japan, but we don't have one between Japan and Korea, and they won't sign it. So right now we're kind of about 90% where you'd like us to be, or where we'd like to be. And the last thing is, and this one is a bit provocative, I suppose, but at some point, right now we've built our system to worry about the arrows. You know, so if this were Hunger Games, you know, we can catch the arrow. But at some point, you got to worry about the archer. And so we have and need to continue to develop capabilities that would allow us to destroy North Korea's nuclear capability if it appears to be on the edge of development. Because the problem with North Korea is they actually use it. You know, I mean, nobody thinks Russia and the United States and China are going to use their nuclear weapons. Even us, me, you know, military, they are a deterrent, and you know, we actually have tried to, not unilaterally, but bilaterally and multilaterally, drive the arsenal down. I actually think North Korea might use it, and so that's kind of a horrifying idea. And if they come close, I think like-minded nations led by us need to make sure they don't have a chance to pull the trigger.
Great. We actually have 10 more minutes, sorry.
Okay.
The taxi's a little late.
Wait a minute, is it happy? What time is it?
It's half.
Is it happy hour yet?
We're in Ireland.
I'm retired now. I don't like to miss happy hour.
Perfect, so we've 10 more minutes. I think we've time probably 2 more questions.
No, I'm kidding. Go ahead.
Who do I choose? Yeah, yourself in the middle.
Good afternoon. I'm from Chicago.
Okay.
My question with regards to cybersecurity. So in the recent year, Russia definitely got about the cyber attack regarding our election system.
Right.
And China's continually attacking our intellectual property. I was wondering if our responses to these attacks are appropriate, because it seems to usually be expelling diplomats and sanctioning intelligence officers.
Yeah, your question kind of gets to it. So there's three words that we have not yet agreed on inside of our own government. So you have cyber harassment, which is DDoS attack, you know, directed denial of services. You familiar with that? Where they'll take a site, Yahoo, and you'll get an attack on Yahoo that just overwhelms it and shuts it down. That's kind of a harassment, right? Then there's cyber espionage, where an attacker, or I'm getting ahead of myself, where someone, a hacker, will go in and take huge amounts of data out, which is what China did. If you wonder what some of China's weapon systems look like ours, you know, a cartoon is a cartoon, and so off they go. That's espionage. And then there's a cyber attack, and we have not yet declared as a nation that we've experienced a cyber attack. So, I mean, you can agree or disagree, but there's people that are really reluctant to do that because, you know, the United States has already been accused of, you know, being the nation that took us down a path of, you know, potential nuclear conflict, and we did. The United States has been accused of developing robotics that are going to lead to all kinds of horrible conflicts in the future. There's still some reluctance on. We've been accused of militarizing space, although frankly the Russians and Chinese are way ahead of that in terms of militarization. We're not sure we want to be the one accused of militarizing the internet, you know, so, or cyber. So we're reluctant to do it. The closest we came is the Sony attack. For those of you that don't know, North Korea attacked Sony, not for purposes of stealing Back to the Future or, you know, Forrest Gump, but rather to destroy Sony's network, and they did. They never published it. I was given a speech in Miami. And I said, because the question came up, just that question, how come we haven't declared attack? How come we don't go offensive ourselves? I explained that, you know, the closest we came was the Sony event, and we debated it. And we debated it because Sony lost about a billion two in hardware and software. And it shut them down for a long period of time. And so the debate was, well, come on, American citizen, American company's been attacked. It wasn't just that they took, you know, CDs out of there. They did take terabytes of information, but they also destroyed hardware. But the decision was that we didn't want to cross that threshold. So then, if it's not an attack, it's an act of espionage, which is best dealt with other instruments of power, economic instruments of power, diplomatic instruments of power, and informational bits of power. Okay, let me end it by saying this. There will be a time when I think that threshold will be crossed. I don't know when, but it's almost inevitable. I mean, you know, right now the technology exists. So if somebody wanted to plant malware in the United, and they might have already done it, by the way, in a U.S. financial sector, and that when activated with a keystroke would literally destroy the financial sector, or in some cases even worse, plant one in the financial system to attack the power grid. That's not hard to do, actually. And then you go to the president and say, whoa, do you want me to shut down the financial sector or shut down the energy sector? Because I can't leave them both operating because they're killing each other. That's not a conversation I'd want to have with the president of the United States. So it's going to happen that there will be something that is absolutely describable as an attack. And when it does, it'll escalate rapidly. And that's why we're trying to be as measured as we can. But it seems to me to be somewhat inevitable, actually.
Very final question from the floor, and I mean it this time. Yeah, you're still at the very end.
In regards to the military interventions over the 2000s and the beginning of the 21st century of the United States in Iraq and Afghanistan, and maybe they weren't done perfectly, do you worry ever that there's a particular weariness among Western populations, especially now with sort of anti-globalization mindset and a more isolationist sort of attitude, that a president like Obama might feel that his hands are tied in how much he can get involved in particular interventions, and you worry that maybe America might be shirking its responsibility on the global stage a bit too much because for political reasons, even though a president might feel that it would be good to make a more strong decision, but doesn't feel like they politically can?
Yeah, I do. Meaning, I do think that the appetite for foreign engagement, not just military, but foreign engagement and interventionism, whether it's for humanitarian purposes or purposes of ridding a country of a dictator or allegedly, you know, weapon system, that appetite comes and goes. Mostly, by the way, not so much on casualties. I have found, you know, there was this theory in the late 90s, mostly after a Somalia incident with the United States military, that the American people had become weary of casualties. The fact is, if you can convince the American people that what you want the soldiers and Marines and airmen to do makes sense, that it has some outcome that is better for the country, they're actually unbelievably supportive. I mean, we are well supported in our country, remarkably so, because I grew up in that army that came out of Vietnam and was not supported. It's one of the reasons I think we have decided to stick with the all-volunteer force. Because you can ask an all-volunteer force to do things that you might not be able to ask a conscript or a draft force to do. So I do think your instinct about, you know, the changes in a population's feelings about what's more important, domestic or interventionist. The best leaders that I've been around, meaning political leaders, have been able to articulate, make sense. I have a phrase I use, leaders have to be sense makers. If you want to lead, you have to be able to make sense of things for those you lead, right? So if you're the president, you got the biggest responsibility to make sense of all. The best presidents have been able to make sense of how to balance our foreign engagement with our domestic needs. And not through the use necessarily of fear, but rather through a very pragmatic conversation about, you know, the fact that we are the world's status quo power. We have economic interest globally. We believe in the rule of law as a matter of our Constitution. We promote democratic values, you know, maybe sometimes, one could argue sometimes too much and in places where they may not be applicable, but the fact is that's who we are. And therefore, you can't, if that's who you are, you can't withdraw to Fortress America and tell the rest of the world, you know, good luck, you know, send us the odd Christmas letter and let us know how your relatives are doing. So, and where does Obama fit into that? I think he got, Obama got off to a really bad start as president in terms of foreign policy. And he got off to a bad start because he ran and said to the American people, I know you're tired of the Middle Eastern wars. I'm not sure he was right about that, to tell you the truth. In fact, he probably wasn't. But because you're tired of it, I'm going to be the president and get you out. By the end of my tenure, I'm going to get you out of Iraq. I'm going to get you out of Afghanistan. We're going to take care of, you know, West Virginia before we take care of Baghdad. And I'm going to use foreign policy far more than I use military. The reason that's the wrong approach is it's a pendulum swing. And pendulum swings are bad in a democracy. You know, you can't go back and forth that dramatically. You know, all in or all out. By the way, by the end of his time, he came around. I mean, we still got 10,000 soldiers in Afghanistan and 5,500 in Iraq. And he wasn't an easy sell, I'll tell you that. But when we were able to show him that we had legitimate interests in being there. And it wasn't just for the Iraqis or the Afghans, it was for us and our system of allies and partners and the spillover effects that come out of the Middle East. He came around. I'll just end by suggesting this about governments in general, whoever's in a government, meaning whoever's leading it at a particular time. Generally, governments do fine if they are a bit ambiguous. So you're never going to know exactly, those of you that are Irish, you're never going to know exactly where the Taoiseach is trying to steer the country. And you shouldn't. You know what I mean? I mean, Otto von Bismarck in Germany once said that, you know, democracy is like sausage. You shouldn't see how it's made. And I have to say, I think that's true. You have to know most about it, but you know, you shouldn't want to know every little ingredient, right? And in any country, whether it's the United States or Ireland or Germany. So it's okay to be a little ambiguous at times if you're a politician. It's okay, for example, for NATO to have a little bit of ambiguity about how committed we are to NATO, or for Taiwan to be a little ambiguous about, you know, how committed we are to the one China. But unpredictability is not good when you're the global power. And I sense we're a little unpredictable right now. But here's my prediction. It won't last. We'll go back to being pretty predictable, maybe a little ambiguous at times. But I think I wouldn't worry if I were you about whether the United States is careening for some kind of disaster. It has too many checks and balances for that to happen. So, well, thanks for your attention here today, and I wish you all the best. And if you want to be a leader someday, just remember, you got to make people belong. All right, thanks. So the James Joyce Award for unintelligible writing. I thank you very much. No, I really do. I appreciate your time. And again, I was very impressed that it was all run by students, for students. I don't think I've seen a faculty, you look like a faculty member. But most of all, I've been interacting with students, and I think that's just fantastic. So.
We get one more round of applause for
Jen? Yeah, well done.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks.
It's a pleasure. Great,
yeah,
thank you.
Great. And now?